rating. For just, you know, because people are in good moods. We would just
start. People were in good moods. People were in good moods.
Are you guys nervous?
For the movie?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Are you a little bit?
Yeah.
You know, I was a little bit nervous.
I hated the other night.
Oh, yeah.
It was really tough for you. About the step and repeat stuff.
What's step and?
What is step and repeat?
Yeah,
by the way,
what that means.
It's like real red carpet. Like you step camera and then.
Well,
do
can I tell you something?
Repeat if you need.
I don't know if it's gonna be the same as it was.
It's not gonna be quite
well.
as
yeah. No, at the well though, it was literally just a square of LA Film Fest thing, and we all just wanted to
be like
in front of it. It wasn't like a big red.
No, it's not gonna
but
be like that.
So they give the illusion of a red.
So I don't know.
Not on camera.
I don't know what red carpet that step and repeat. What is that?
Okay, more water. Can he bring you?
Thank you.
Thank you so
like
much.
A lame excuse. Thank you for this. Haha, ha, I got
what
ice.
What kind of boogers?
You don't want ice. Never wanted ice. Never
what
wanted
kind of boogers?
Ice.
What kind of glue rays.
This is a really cool pad.
Indiana
here.
Jones.
Wow.
Super cool.
These are great.
We have the official Avatar 3D glasses, which they say.
Oh.
Should we all wear the 3D glasses during dinner?
If you like, it's,
can
we you know, strange
to be guessing. I don't know. I don't know what this thing is.
There are all kinds of 3D glasses up there.
I think you guys. No.
No, get the color ones.
Yeah.
The color ones are for the kids' movies. And they actually have branding.
You
on.
Want yellow or blue?
I'll take
the IMAX
orange.
You want to put it over your glasses? It's
oh my gosh.
Maybe easier.
Everything's in 3D.
I want orange.
Whoa. The Avatar glasses.
It's like you're right there.
It's like so good that it's like 4D. Oh wait,
that's Shrek 4D.
We should all like lean back like this.
Enjoy the experience.
Look, this is a family
that's
film.
A good one. It's literally a family. Well, you know, the people who were in here just before you were also had pregnant girls. That was their movie to pregnant teenagers. Yeah.
Really?
Yes. It's pregnant teenager day here at the house, apparently.
Well,
you were not in that movie.
She's
as far
20
as we know.
In the movie, so she's quite not, and she just edges right out of it.
Do you say that she's 20 in the movie?
No.
Okay.
I wrote it in the
script, I know I look like I'm 12.
Well, you were under 20. You just turned 20, didn't you? Like this year?
Me?
Yeah.
I just turned 19.
Oh, 19. So you're still not 20.
Yeah.
Yeah. I turned 20.
What, 200 years ago?
Oh,
see, that's what happens when you hit 30.
Shots fired.
Not 30 yet.
You're not 30 yet? Okay.
Burn.
Almost there. It's the, you know, it's just the,
it's the
movie
glasses.
Has added years.
So was it like this the entire time you made the movie?
With the glasses?
No, with this friendly attitude you all have about each other.
Yeah. I think so.
Except for the times you made me cry.
Except for the crying.
Oh, did he make you cry ever?
Not on purpose.
Did you make her
cry? Ryan can cry on command. Just like that.
You have that skill?
Command. He has a skill. And it only works only if everybody is looking at him.
Yeah.
Isn't that crazy?
And everyone's
if
quiet.
Everyone's looking and quiet and waiting for him and like expecting him to do it because we're running out of time, only then.
Waterworks. Waterfalls.
And maybe with Haley, it's if nobody's looking at her?
With Haley,
tears start flowing.
She's got a more complicated.
Everyone got blindfolds on. The boom
she's
guy,
got a more complicated.
He's knocking into stuff.
Well, every scene of mine was a scene that someone would be freaking out with.
Freaking out.
And crying in real life. So it was just.
Father sad. He's done something
he's
stupid.
He's just an idiot.
She's basically. She's just harassed and kicked around and disrespected the whole movie. And it's. It's really, really, really the movie I wanted to make.
Gender equality.
It's perfect. So, how did you all come together in the first place?
I don't know.
Just basic auditions? Is that the.
I'm conflicted whether or not I should keep these auditions.
You can change colors.
I'm only
going to
answer my questions.
Okay. Well,
the orange
Haley,
is a good color
how did you come aboard the film?
Well. I was doing another movie with Seth Kaplan, who produced this movie and the other movie that's also in the film festival, which is pretty cool.
Premiered
and
a couple days ago.
Yeah, premiered. Was that last night?
No,
two
the
nights
night
ago.
Before.
2 nights ago.
So is this more of a horror movie to you, or is that more of a horror movie to you?
I think this is probably more of a horror like real life horror.
Yeah.
The worst thing.
That's the way I've been describing it is like, they're like, which one? I mean, everyone's been like, well, obviously, you know, The Well was so much more, you know, challenging to get into this character and into this world. And I'm like, you know, that was physically challenging and that was obviously emotionally, like, wacky. But this was like... nuts. It was,
well,
you know, the character.
This off. This is
yeah, I think we all just feel a little dumb.
It was fun while it lasted. Well, as she said, Seth came to me like a few months before we started shooting and said, I've got the, you're going to meet this girl. She's great. She should be the girl for the movie. And I was okay, we'll see. I'll meet this person.
Very skeptical.
Well, because you never want to be told, you know, like, right. It's this person. It's not like he told me anything, but then I met
And her. You're a couple months before shooting, and you're not nervous about who your lead actress is going to be at all?
It was like 3 months.
Yeah, maybe. It was a bit before.
Well, we didn't find him until about 9 or 10 days before shooting.
Yeah. They saw a lot of
people. I was walking on the street. Lots of people. No, it was an exhaustive search. We saw a lot of people. I basically went through IMDb top, you know, 25 and under, male, you know, and then once we crossed off Robert Pattinson and a couple other people,
you were left with me.
No, we were left like 1,000 people are, you know, and the top 1,000 will be, you know, of that list will be people who are have an agent or even like on the grid or acting at all. Mm-hmm. So we just went through all of them and watched.
And then this guy was like 500 million on IMDb.
500 million one.
Yeah. No, I saw the thing that I liked was I saw him on an episode of Mike and Molly. That's what I found.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Did you watch the episode?
I just watched him.
Was he playing Mike or Molly?
He was playing either. He was playing a young man who resembled himself. And then he came in for the audition. And I was just really hoping, like, please get somebody just come in now. I'm just really screwed. We don't have. And when he just came in, you know, and I'm sure from his side, he's like, coming in, you know, I'm just reading. I hope I get this. Maybe not. Not, you know.
Yeah.
But for me, I'm like, play it cool. Keep him on the ropes.
He did a good job. He's very good at being, like, centered and in control and aware of himself and what he's saying. And I remember as soon as I walked into the audition room, too, I was like, man, this guy seems like he's got a good direction. He knows where he's going. And then I started working with him.
He knows where he wants to go, but he just wants to go 50 different places.
I think if
Which
I...
Which is good for a filmmaker.
I think if I was maybe too... if I could do it all over again. I was maybe too specific, like all the
maybe
time.
And too over specific.
I would maybe over explain things a lot, say it has to be done exactly like this.
Yeah, but I like that. I like
he liked it.
I like the
he liked
options.
It.
Yeah.
She's a little firecracker.
No! It was like something new. It was a learning experience times a billion, and I think maybe for both of us.
Mm-hmm. Well, I expected a lot from you guys, and they delivered.
Because you were being intensely directed, or because you were doing a part that was different than
the
other
part? Well, it was like when you read the script and you envision yourself doing it, and I try not to think too much. I don't have any like method. I don't plan out how I'm going to say things, you know? I just.
That's true in real life, too. Yeah.
Well, there we go. There are some good sides and bad sides to that, so let's not make it a complete negative thing.
Well, there goes this. I should start crying now. This is how you get into crying.
Oh, God. But, you know, like, sometimes I was just like, I just want to do this, and I just want to get it out and try it the way, like, it comes and, like, you know, organically. And he came over and he's like, you know, this is exactly how I want you to say these three words and in this way, and I want you to be feeling this exact thing and maybe sit in this position and look off that way.
Right. That's the thing that I felt like. Although I was very careful to never, like, say, you know, say it.
Yeah,
this
he
way.
Never lied read, which was he great. Never he never, because some directors, they'll come in and they'll...
But I do feel like sometimes with the... You know, with the movements and the, like, you know, look up this way and that.
And
know,
I want
it'll look good on
I
camera, but I should have found better ways to.
But do you think it's because you had young actors, or because you just were figuring it out still?
Yes. All of the above.
I don't want to make him
look bad. No, he I don't want to make him look bad either.
But let me tell you,
he was really great.
I realized these things. Like, I remember one scene in particular that I had a lot of trouble with.
Which one was that?
The scene where I'm calling.
Close your ears.
And first of all, I didn't know it was going to be, the movie was going to be as funny as it is.
That's and both so, of them
like,
said
here
that.
Here I'm taking myself so seriously is, and like doing this like in this dramatic way, which ended up making it look, I think, better because it kind of is pitiful how like.
Well, that's how you get laughs. So yeah, that's by playing it straight. Yeah.
Yeah. So you know that's something I learned.
Which one was it?
The one scene where I'm calling my dad and telling him I'm pregnant, and it was like I'm pretty sure late at night, and like he had gone home and. We had been working since like early in the morning. Yeah, somehow you weren't escaped. In that scene. But I just remember I was like, you know, this is a scene that I tell my dad who I have this like terrible relationship with that I'm pregnant, and I'm like have it kind of envisioned this one way in my head, and Kerem's getting at me, and then I start like.
Yeah, that was that.
But
was,
I realize now that
it worked for that.
It worked, and like the way that ended up happening. And the way that what things you were trying to get out of me that I didn't really agree with initially were better.
Yeah, it's sometimes a beautiful thing when. Well, I'm so used to comedy of stand up where it's in your face and
it's like
punchline setup joke. Here's this and doing this, I kind of got exposed to this sense of comedy where the funny comes from the situation and the realness of the moment and how. You can relate to that and how you can see these people going through this hard time and they're not funny, nothing, there's no jokes, but it's funny. And
it's just like, God, this is so right.
And the trailer that we did when we were filming that scene, that was a very, the scene where she tells me that she's pregnant, I remember filming that vividly and thinking lots of stressful thoughts and I was not in a funny mindset. Right. And then when I watched it, and it was really funny.
And then
really
he lifts up his eyebrow, and
then I just start doing this stuff.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's. But I think that goes to him. A lot of that is actors. I feel that are just this mold of clay, and the director's job is to well direct and to pull that in different.
And that's funny too, because I had to sometimes pull you back in the other way.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, you know, I initially took everybody down, everybody to like this
real,
more real level.
Mm-hmm.
And then, but then when I wanted him to kind of turn on the. You know, all the goofy stuff that he does.
You can say shit, it's okay.
Oh, well.
Curse all you like.
This is a family film.
Oh, yeah. Right.
No, I think there's two.
Did you say poop?
There's two F-bombs in the movie, so maybe it's not that.
Oh, two?
And two, yeah.
I was supposed to
you
say
you have to cut one for the R.
I think so, yeah.
Or for the PG-13.
Yeah.
For the airplane, say frick.
That's right.
Frick.
Oh, frog.
Frog you.
No, but I did have to sometimes say, like, you know.
Should de-serious him?
De-seriotize him.
Mm-hmm.
And just tell him, you know. This time, go just way beyond. What was our.
Down to, like, the voiceover stuff. Because a lot of it was voiceover. And when I would attack it, I was very, like, animated, and I'd go up in these inflections that I wouldn't go to normally. Or I would go to, and then he would really just be like an architect and kind of push notes down and push things up. And then hearing it, I go, wow, that was really subtle and soft and nice. And hearing it how I would do it is totally, completely wrong. he's great. I owe a lot to him.
Well, it seems like the great challenge of your performance, and I guess maybe finding the actor, is that he's kind of a prick. But you kind of want to still like him.
Yeah,
I mean, it's because it's what he does is terrible. I mean, it's not funny even. It's horrible behavior.
It's tough
for a guy to do.
Play the unfavorable opinion of what you want to do with these kids, where he doesn't necessarily want them, and of course you want the guy to be the cool guy and the man to want these kids and to.
What's that? He's too chicken shit to actually say what he wants. That's really painful to watch through the movie.
Yeah,
I find that the way that
I feel like I brought everybody down.
They'll
you thought it was capacity, a very happy comedy.
The audience's capacity for forgiveness is so huge, you know, and they want to forgive is what I've sort of found. Like the worse that the person behaves and, you know, and the worse that they are, if there's like that little glint at the end and then they sort of figure it out, you know, like House or something, you know, characters like that, like you always just hope he's going to, you know, have some piece of humor. Not like he was like House.
You're just like House.
Wait,
you're just that terrible bastard.
out.
No, he's just in a really tough situation, and he doesn't, you know, he's caught between, would you say, the right, what he thinks is the right thing to do, and how he actually feels, and what he has to realize is the right thing to do is to say how you feel.
Yeah, and most of the stuff I've ever done too is
Should we put that in the poster?
Sometimes the right thing to do, or I don't know, it's in there somewhere.
A very special movie.
Right.
And sometimes, oh geez, I forgot what I was going to say. Now.
I have that effect.
It's okay with me.
Am I allowed to talk? Ever.
25 shooting days of this.
Okay, so what was I gonna say?
You were gonna tell us something about how pretty I am.
No, I have something. You were talking about the audience and how they wanna forgive, and you, and really I think the audience, any audience, you know, whether you're reading a book, watching a movie, you kind of are going to believe whatever you
really... God. It was just
God telling me to shut up. Because I don't know where I'm going. Well, no, I do, though. But connecting to what I have to say is, I think the audience, something I learned on this is that the audience is going to kind of believe whatever they want to believe in the moment watching the movie. And I remember with a couple of things, Kerem taught me this one thing that I think is the coolest thing you ever taught me.
What was
So he told me there was this scene after shit gets real with this guy, and I'm walking away and he's been a dick and stuff, so I'm walking away and I'm storming out of there and I've got my boxes and I've packed my stuff and I'm going back to my wherever I'm going, and
I don't want to give anything away, it sounds like.
Oh, sorry.
No, you're doing a good job.
You just get...
I'm doing a good... Okay, so I'm just going... Well, also, who knows? I didn't know where I was going.
Right.
I moved.
You didn't know.
Anyways, so he told me, he said after I did it a couple times, and, you know, I looked all sad and stuff, he was like, Healy, I forget who told you, or where you saw this, but he said that there was this study that you read about where there are these pictures, this guy asked random people to take pictures, just like blank face, and then they show them to one like focus group and they say, tell me what this person looks like their emotion, or they, what, you explain it.
It's a very old film school like thing, a Kuchelov effect, this guy, you know, the old Russian film school or early 20th century of how he would just edit a face. I was just telling her about the Kuchelov effect. You show a guy's blank face and then you show a picture of a meal, and then they cut back and forth between that, and then they'll show somebody else the same blank face, cut to somebody getting stabbed, you know, and just different things. And when you ask the audience
what you see
in the person's face, it always depends on what they've cut to.
Right.
Yeah, matter how you feel like you're acting it in the moment, sometimes you'll watch it or some other people watch it and they'll have a completely different idea of what you were thinking and what your motive was.
Right, so you don't have, that was the whole point, you don't have to really emote. You don't have to think about emoting so much as just doing
less is
what
more.
You're less what more, you're supposed to do in the scene.
And I remember what I was going to say about the people now.
Are we making any sense?
Sporadically.
So I was always used to doing key part roles and like sidekick brother roles, so I never had to do something where I was like kind of the lead of the film. Mm-hmm. And my biggest fear going into it was...
You were the lead?
Was her. my biggest fear going into it was worried if I could...
You were the lead of the film?
If I could intrigue people enough for an hour and a half to want them to root for me. Because I personally don't find myself to be that interesting.
Yeah, neither does anyone else. It's a good thing you have that fear.
So that was really hard for me to do. Rehearsal was really
tough. I never
really
even heard that out from
really?
You, ever.
No, I've never heard him say this. Been like that. So, now you know.
Well, you know, it's funny since you brought it up that...
He's just trying to look all humble. And
Well, you guys are working opposite tips. But since you brought up how Haley looks, or maybe Haley brought up how she looks, I don't remember anymore, but it seems like hours ago.
Correct.
But the movie doesn't actually lean on that very heavily. It seems to be like a choice you made not to make that, you know, the central issue in the film.
The what? The how
she looks.
looks.
The
and
idea that
to.
She's the you know the girl who is he's he would want to obtain. I mean, there's always that there's that element of you know him having his first sex or whatever, but there's not
right,
that kind
yeah,
of like
kind of dispense
the guy
that.
Going after the girl he can't get,
oh,
and
yeah,
therefore
no.
That's just like not part of this movie at all,
right.
Which is surprising.
They're too. I mean, he is an idiot, like the way he handles things, but like I'm
go on
nuts. But your character.
I know what you mean, dude. Like somebody, you know, like the unattainable girl, and she's really hot, and I want to
yeah.
get with her. And
it's not knocked up. I mean, in that
right.
regard, it's not.
Yeah.
So yeah, let's all talk about how I'm not the unattainable hot girl. Okay.
Are you kidding me? Look at these heels.
No, I really.
Is that on your card? Is that on your like special?
No,
skill?
To your credit. To your credit. No, we she is set up that way initially, but
right.
you really want to.
Yeah.
You, I wanted. We wanted to get past that quickly. You know, just mm-hmm. to sort of. That's the first 5 minutes of the movie, and then you sort of dispense with that, and then now you're. Because if you for somebody who's in this situation,
mm-hmm.
not that I've ever been in this situation, but if somebody, the way I thought of it was, you know, on the you'd initially be you know want to be with this girl, and then. If you got her pregnant and you don't, I mean, that would take over, I think. That emotion of, I want to rewind and I've never met you and I got to get out of this somehow. And the fact of her being a really sweet, pretty, fun, smart,
just
beautiful,
vulnerable,
nice girl. Yeah. Just is what gets him back into the whole thing. So,
yeah.
Yeah. That was definitely something
young
that I wanted to.
Kieslowski, young no more.
Young.
So she is developed in
it's
a way where it's kind of interesting where you wonder with this didn't happen where she would be with stuff.
Yeah.
Because there's that whole conversation about, you know, saving herself that she's using as an image, and then there's the books, and there's like all this stuff going on, and then her life kind of stops also, which is interesting.
I
don't know. Where do you think she would be?
Well, who knows where they go at the end of this movie, you know?
I know.
Straight to the top.
Well, I don't know. I feel like Mallard would probably never get married. I feel like she's like so stubbornly independent, but really she's not independent that she would never really
get married, but then never admit that she might want to get
married.
She's
got some like developing serious mental problems too, I think. Or is that at least how I.
Wow.
She's got like some.
You put a lot of thought
into this. This is a very dark sequel.
She put a lot of herself into the character.
But she is. She's nuts.
Yeah.
She's.
And her father secretly seems to be a right wing guy, extreme rightist.
He's nuts too, though. And like, I don't have a mother figure. I pretty much don't have a father figure. Who
knows? She's kind of alone. And
I'm lost on my mind.
And she kind of goes from different thing to different thing, you know.
Yeah, and she's. I don't know. I think she's the kind of girl that, like, if she didn't have the mind that she has, she could have friends and she could be, like, in the cooler kids group, you know? And but she doesn't have any friends and she isn't.
She gets. You have the one friend.
Well, she seems to choose not
my
to be
roommate?
In that group.
Hi, Jing. You guys, sort of.
Yeah, she gets sweet towards the end.
But she seems like one of those girls who doesn't really want to be part of the cool table. Like, she's too cool for the cool table.
I can see that.
Yeah, she probably thinks she's like intellectually above it all.
But it is interesting.
That kind of belies, though, a certain, you know.
But maybe she just tells herself that
right.
she's too cool for it because
she doesn't feel like
there.
She's up for it.
Yeah.
And she doesn't have it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe you guys should just make some room and Haley could lay down on the couch. Or
maybe this could be
a
like a
session
moment for Mallard.
No, this really is starting to sound more like you now than.
But it's interesting thing about the film in general, I think, that you don't, there are all kinds of cliches that are there that you don't pick up on, which I find interesting. Like the father, who the book covers you chose, you know, or created or whatever, he looks like he's, you know, on Fox News every other week doing a spot.
The
you
false
know.
Flag.
Yeah, I mean, there's that kind of like thing, and yet that you don't lie in that either. You don't like make him into the religious or to the political.
Because also, I mean, he's kind of,
he
for as much as you don't like him,
he's
the voice of reason
so good,
in the movie, you know? He's the one, nobody else, everyone else is, you know, tiptoeing around this, their whole situation, and he's just laying it out there, and this is how it is, and this is what real life is like.
But mom is kind of reasonable, too.
Mom is reasonable, but above all, nice, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, it fell off?
And so she's maybe...
We have to start over, my mic.
But
hi, like, Dave. Thanks for having us.
I'm lying.
You know, Brad's on 3D glasses.
Let's all start over.
Let's put the 3D glasses back.
Young Kieslowski. I'm Haley Lou Richardson.
No, I'm Haley Lou Richardson. I'm Haley Richardson. I started.
He's even growing his hair out. This is exactly like.
I am.
Wow.
I am. You should have seen me on the set. It was like just like that.
Yeah, he had it down to his knees. No, it was like right here for the.
It was.
For the hair. When we shot it. It was really.
And cool. Then we found out that we were going to premiere at LAFF, so I decided time to look presentable, put on a clean shirt.
Yeah. He thinks that's presentable.
In LA, downtown. That
yeah,
is presentable.
This is a big step for me.
You see, at least
unless
his
he's pushing a shopping awesome. Cart, he's fine.
Ben still, you're on like the costume. But yeah, the cliche, as far as the cliches and those things go, I feel like the film does a really good job of not forcing any of that on you and not saying, this is how we want you to think of this person. It's more of a, this is who they are, and you decide. And I like that. I think it's a very nice, soft, very cool approach.
So do you guys see the movie on a DVD or something, or have you seen it with any kind of audience?
I watched it on my iPad.
Did you?
No.
I convinced like, them to send me some version
we
of it.
We sent her.
I gave it to my mom for Christmas. Yeah. That was my Christmas present to my mom.
I couldn't say no to that. I really wanted to say no. Well, I wanted her to see it. I wanted her to see it in a theater with the color and the sound mix and everything, and I thought it would just be this great. And she's like, well, but I want my, this is a this is a Christmas gift for my mom.
And do you think your mom think you were telling her something subtly that she should know, or?
Well, my dad did have to close his eyes at some part.
Oh, man. Jeez, I wonder what that's like. That's gotta be. Yeah.
It's funny you say that the color's not fixed. I hear color correction is like the biggest. Every time we had the DP, Rick Diaz, every time I see him post on Facebook something about a clip, he always has to mention, go see LA Film Fest, is this, it's not color corrected yet, just letting you guys know.
It's like not color corrected?
Well, I thought you were tonight? Asian in the version I saw.
No, no.
It's not color.
I thought you were Asian in the version I saw.
You're saying
that I was
the movie is color corrected.
It is color corrected. We've corrected
it. It is not safe to see the movie.
Seth posted some picture on Instagram of a screenshot of me and I'm blue. He's like, color correction's going great, y'all. And I'm like, yep, I look like an avatar. So I commented that on.
Look like
they
Krishna.
They have a Blu-ray.
So are you excited about, will you watch it with an audience?
Today?
Yeah.
Oh, duh.
Yeah, they were, I believe you are invited.
To the premiere?
The question is, are you, Kerem?
I was
maybe
tough.
You're invited,
I
had to
will you sit through the movie again, though, with the audience? Are you looking forward to that? Is this the first time it's been seen by an audience, by the way?
It's been seen in with, smaller tests, like 20 people, but never like this. Will I sit there? Of course I will. But
of course you will.
But the day, it's funny because someone else asked me this yesterday. And until they asked me that, it didn't occur to me that, like, oh, this is going to be a nerve-wracking
thing.
Experience. I'm sure on the day I'll be, when it's happening, I'll be. It's
which is today.
Which is today.
It is
today.
So your nerves are not really racked. Great. You don't seem very racked.
No, for me, it always happens right before. Right when it says PSH Collective presents in association with the facility.
There'll be lots of laughs and cries and
then
screams.
I think, oh,
and
no.
You wonder what Karen's like when he gets nervous? He doesn't like freak out. He just stops talking and he starts just going like this and nodding to people. Like I remember when you were stressed out on set, you'd have all these people coming up to you and we'd be like we'd be like 5 hours over like when we were supposed to be done. And you'd just have your hands in your pocket and you'd be looking at people every time someone would come up to you and just go like this.
This is the payback for the crying.
There you go.
Whenever he needs space too, like he needs like a moment, it's never like, okay, go to a reunion. It's just a simple.
Oh my god, I'm not even aware of this.
Or really? One time, no, there was this one scene.
Terrible.
There was this one scene that I could tell he was really nervous about. It's the scene where we first meet. It's like the epic scene at the party where like
epic.
No.
And he looked at me and he grabbed me and he was like, I'm nervous for you in this scene. He's like going like this to people. He comes up to me and I'm like, Kerem, like, do you want to talk? He's like, yeah, I want to. He's like, I'm nervous about how you're going to be.
I said how this is going to turn out. That, like, I'm worried about this scene the most. I'm not sure. I think I bought you didn't tell me. Like, I'm not sure if this was.
We
writing.
Had like done the rehearsal, the camera
scene.
Blocking, like we were about to shoot
She's
the scene.
About
and he
to shoot.
Me
it was like the worst.
Like, I pulled the camera. Like,
I'm
okay, guys, come
what
on.
What did
let's
you
go.
Like about the scene?
I mean, in the end of the day, it worked great. But at the
now
time.
Now you love the scene.
Now I love it. Yeah, but at the time,
Not love it? You don't love the scene?
I said now I love it.
Oh, I think you said not now love it. Loves it.
No, now I love it. Now it's my favorite scene of the film.
Now it's going to win the TV award.
But see, part of it. To write something and have it. You know, this was your project and.
Yeah, it's hard. Well, the hardest thing is when you write it and you do the first run through to get it up. And, you know, it's hard for all the actors and they're kind of just getting their lines and they're moving right. But seeing it that first time, you think, oh God, this is terrible. Why did it? This is so
terrible.
Bad.
Yeah.
Not because of you guys. More just like, it's just not there. It's, you know, 40%.
It's
not
going to
work.
It's not there. It's not edited. There's so much space between people talking. And, you know, you just think, you know, I started to learn how to control that. Like, you know,
Gag reflex.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. To realize, the first time it's going to be bad. It's going to be, you know, rough.
See, I always thought that the greatest moment on a set was when good actors actually said your lines the way they were meant to be said, or found something even better in it.
That
was like the greatest.
That happens. That's really great when that happens. Yeah. Well, one of my favorite moments actually was on the crying, him crying, and we were really close over his shoulder. You remember this?
Yeah.
In this parking lot, and you know he's up for anything, and. You know, it's a really emotional scene, and he's just kind of crying like this. But he also knows that, like, okay, he's got to do it for the camera, and he knows that no matter how he feels.
Put here, step there, face there,
right, light, exactly.
Face, right?
So, like, while we're shooting this thing, I just reach out onto his hips, and I'm just slowly moving him like this, and he's still doing the scene. That was a point where I felt like.
In control.
Yeah.
Puppet master.
But then, it's more like I was a puppet master, but he was he was Pinocchio. Like he had come to life. You know, he was a boy too. You know.
I've never heard myself call Pinocchio. That's hilarious.
And did Haley ever really come to life?
Yeah, I guess not.
Haley,
I guess this is just.
No, Haley is amazing. I love it.
Yeah.
I can't imagine anybody else having done
it. And he was so great. Oh, that's funny.
Yeah, Kerem. You're amazing.
That phone call scene actually worked out really well.
Yeah, I did.
She calls her dad.
So how are you guys going to live without each other? Mm. It seems like you have to get together and do this every week just to, you know, have some laughs.
We should. Yeah. I try.
Same time next year.
It is fun. It's like a year later and we're...
Almost exactly. Year later.
Almost. Yeah. I'm telling you, to the day.
To the day, almost.
To the day
we started filming today.
We started filming June 15th, tomorrow.
Yeah.
Tomorrow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Wow.
Oh, guys.
And would you have done anything differently now that you're a year older? Not you. your years don't really count.
I think that
mine are more valuable.
Yeah. What would you have done differently, Haley?
Well, you know, I learned this from watching The Well. The other night, I was cringing the whole time, not because, you know, the movie, I wasn't happy with the movie, but because I wasn't happy with me and I was in every scene of the movie. So, I just...
Now you're a real actor.
I think it's something that every actor, you know, has and struggles with. Is
Paul
like,
Newman could not watch his own movies.
Well, the thing is, it's because if you want to keep getting better, you're going to keep learning always. I want to always keep learning and working harder and harder and discovering new things, like, until the day I die. And when I watched myself in The Well, I was like, shit, like, I was so just, like, an immature actor in some things.
But
and I'm
she
still
was really,
an immature actor.
She's
but
really
just,
hard on herself, too. I mean, there was other scenes where you were upset that one at the party scene, but that was because of me. And the... This other scene where it was, you know, kind of a very serious scene between you two, and she was upset about. I just couldn't tell what she was upset about, and then I realized it was because she thought she wasn't doing a good job in the scene, and then I had to remember, like, oh, you should say that she's doing a good job. You should tell her this because she is doing a good job, but then the other side of me was like, well.
I kind of like her in that place.
I kind of like her in this
so
place
let's
right now.
Suffer.
So why don't we just keep shooting this, and then I'll tell her at the end of it and that she did a really good job. But we'll keep her a little bit. And
rated on a scale of 1 to 10, Kerem.
She asked me to do this. She really did. She said, how was my performance rated on a scale of 1 to 10? And I said...
That was not me completely serious.
No, but it was pretty serious.
9.5
100%. 100, no. I said... It was 100%.
Okay,
I said,
so anyways...
I said 85% is what I said to her. For this reason, because I was like, look, you're awesome, but I don't want to give you... Make you think that, like... You can't get any better. I know you are just going to get better and better.
I always got 9.5.
And that was the wrong thing to say. Just tell you
well,
that.
Well, I
always say 100%. This is like woman 101. I get a 9. How do I look? And amazing. There's not change nothing.
So both you and your character went through this journey.
Yes.
Of learning about women.
Holy X.
It all came together.
You don't want a straight, they don't want the answer. You want the best.
Okay. Yeah. Just do everything the opposite.
Oh, God.
We got the scene exactly as I wanted it. Now, so that I have some options.
Do it completely different.
So now we get some usable footage. And
so the sequel will be when he gets pregnant with twins. And the wacky hijinks that ensue.
I am thinking of a sequel, actually.
Arnold Schwarzenegger.
I'm thinking of a sequel, actually, like maybe in 10 years later.
10 years later.
And you'll probably be able to afford a second baby by then.
Yeah. We had 22 babies.
We had two babies?
Like, yeah. 7-day-old babies.
But you shot them both in singles.
They actually trusted me
to hold
them in
there. There's a shot with
two of them that wasn't composited? Okay. I thought it was a composite because it like seemed like you were shooting... Right.
There were two 7-day-old
babies.
There's
one shot that
they were there.
Let me tell you, those mothers of the actual babies, them putting them into my hands.
Oh my God,
they were
like terrified.
So scared. They were like, okay.
I thought, oh my God, the lights are gonna fall on them, and this is that.
Good thing I was. That was the worst day.
It was really hot there too. It was a hospital. It was the one place we couldn't shoot on location because it was a hospital.
Oh, don't you dare complain! I was the one with the like 32-pound pregnant belly on.
Right.
But you weren't crowning, so everything was okay. Because that's really...
Method acting.
Method, yes.
Yeah.
You're only 5 centimeters dilated, so we did.
I actually gave birth to those babies.
Wow, that's impressive. No wonder you wanted to give this to your mother. Mom, you have grandchildren.
That was an experience. Though. I had to give them back. That scene, I remember filming that, her screaming like legitimately and with the babies. And then when they did come out, they were the cutest little kids I've ever seen in my life.
Are we giving away
just like real life?
Oh, are we?
Well, I'm assuming that people won't go to the movie thinking that she gets... The babies die in an accident.
Are people going to go to the movie?
You'll find out in a couple hours, won't you?
I thought we were talking, what am I?
Movie? When's lunch?
I'm ready to watch a movie, though.
But yeah, I think that watching this movie tonight, I'm definitely going to cringe and wish that I could do the movie now, you know, again.
You do wish that, like at the end of the last 2 weeks of the shoot. I was kind of, you know, I thought, man, I wish now we could just do the first week of the shoot again. You know, I always feel that, even on the previous film.
Yeah.
Because you get into a groove and then...
First scene filming, too, it was, as maybe wasn't, like you said, as you like to go back into the first week. But that first scene, too, I felt...
But that
was... in the beginning, we were kind of in the clip.
Yeah.
From one point, at a certain level.
That was a good scene to shoot first. We shot the scene.
It was a scary scene to shoot first.
The scene where they kind of had the first serious discussion, okay, what are we going to do? And he's, you know... am I saying the right thing? You know, they're not really gelling at all in the movie. So that was a good scene, I think, to shoot first, even though it was a very long...
And then this guy had to write half the movie, me in dripping wet clothes. Yeah. So, like...
That's funny. The editor, like, when I went in, the editor had done an assembly, and... Oh, the things
funny.
You talk He's about with the editor about and with the actors and what they do and everything, it's like, I would... Oh my God! Thank God they weren't there. But he said, you know, I mean, Ryan's really good. He's really funny, but this one, he has this kind of tick he falls back on, which is this sniffle. He'll always go like that. He'll always do that. And then
because I had pneumonia.
Because he would literally, truly was wet for the first 2 weeks of shooting. Just like, let's time to shoot, wet down, pose.
We're gonna have this big montage scene where he's wet and he's running and across Los Angeles.
We literally gave him a cold, like a pretty gnarly one.
But it was all worth it.
But it's all worth it in the end.
Yeah,
and you're still one big happy family.
We are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice read.
Happy smiles.
Oh yeah.
Okay, now I want you to say yeah again, and the intention is.
Yes.
Come on, Bear. Come on.
The intention is you mean it. Mean it. They're going to edit this part together. Okay. Yeah, oh my God, we're such a
good family. Such a happy family.
Fine.
I feel nervous.
I feel like there's someone between us.
I had a lot of peanut butter and jelly sandwiches this one scene.
Oh man, her sandwich creations? Let me tell you. Tell about your
We're getting into the B-sides now. What? We sort of got through all the
set,
interest.
I made everyone... Okay, so like the last bit of the thing,
She didn't make anything for anybody.
Yes, I did! I was
except
like...
problems.
I made these creative sandwiches that I made.
I was going to leave that one on the table.
We had nothing on the crafty table, but like soggy pieces of wheat bread, peanut butter, pretzels, like granola bars. So I would make creative sandwiches where I would... for like the crew and Rick and Kerem, and I would make these sandwiches with peanut butter, pretzels. I would do up granola bars and Snickers and like put it on there. Sometimes I would put potato chips, more peanut butter, Nutella, and I'd close the sandwich and I'd give it to
This is the clip they're going to show from this interview. Is
okay. Now try to plug the movie a little bit.
And while we were doing that, we were filming a movie.
Well, the legend will be when everybody dies from diabetes on this film. It will be your fault.
I definitely standards go down. Since we're on the subject, mine was the Nutella, copious amounts of Nutella, and then
potato chips.
No, what was it? Mixed salted nuts.
Yeah,
smashed together. And
I don't know why. I don't think
it.
I had time to eat.
And can I tell you the reason why?
Because you were wet.
Because I was really in a corner.
Well, I ate so much the first part of the movie that I like got fat. And so the
and then we shot all the pregnancy stuff, and it was great.
Oh wait, no, that movie,
God, see, that's another thing.
Like,
another example of a thing.
That
do
I
not
couldn't be
say.
Fat anymore. So I was like trying to make other people all these fattening foods, so I would like be able to like smell the peanut butter and.
And meanwhile, she's not eating at all,
and it's
like in between takes is like trying having to sit down and. Do this, and I'm like, Haley, please just eat
what
some
happened?
Lunch.
Oh, you mean it?
Please.
I like, towards the
you got into your head that now
with,
she's
like,
fat.
Three pieces of shrimp and carrots.
So it's like one half Dom DeLuise movie, one half Dallas Buyers Club. Is that?
Yeah, that's what it was.
It's like a castaway, you know. We'd
we're taking a little time off.
Except the difference is that she didn't actually get fat. She was looked the
she
same.
She was girl fat.
Yeah, exactly.
In her head, she was fat.
Right.
She gained
oh, I got.
Was, 3/4 of a pound. And therefore,
you know, these indie films, there's you get, get you. Donuts every morning, not eggs.
What are you talking about? We had eggs every morning.
And eggs are fattening, too.
Eggs are fattening.
Did we?
We had hot breakfast every morning.
Yeah, we had good hot breakfast.
Well, that's not you.
You know, that's,
about you
you know why? Because you didn't get there. You got
well,
there late.
The call time would be 4 o'clock and my call time would be 6.
Oh,
so
yeah.
I'd get there at 6 and the breakfast was gone.
This is one of his tricks. Don't feed Haley.
One of his director tricks.
I'm sorry. Hey, next time.
I honestly think that's what Seth smoked. I think that was his goal,
to not feed me.
Because,
oh, yeah.
To be ready for the other
because
film.
Because the same thing happened with the other film
producer.
Where I got fat.
Seems to be a recurring issue. What is going on?
This is very dangerous territory.
Bring in her agent.
Yeah, we're stepping on line minds here with this conversation.
I'm recusing myself. I know better than to get involved in this game.
She is a fantastic actress.
And he's 100%. He's the star of the movie. He's the star. He makes the movie. I mean, it's him.
Yeah,
it's all him.
It's him.
It's all him. And the producers who were awesome, and the executive producers, Chris Colbert.
Yeah, it's
and your agents.
It's
and your agents,
awesome.
For God's sake.
It's oh, yeah.
Cool.
They weren't really research. Involved. They kind of were.
Working
I mean,
on
they
a,
did a lot of stuff.
On an
no, but it really is true that. Sorry,
no,
I just have to say they real the best producing group I could have asked for. I mean, you know, you hear all these stories maybe about the producers are making you do something or something like that, but it wasn't like that at all. Everybody was from the executives down on down. They were all just. Trying to make the movie as good as it could be, and they all had really great ideas, and then, you know, they let us, they had faith in me to make the call, and so.
Yeah, it definitely
that's,
felt
that's
like
a serious moment here.
We were all going towards a common objective, and we're all, that's the difference between shooting something on an indie film and shooting like a studio film, is sometimes in the studio film you get those higher up guys, or even some of the low guys, who are there just for the money in their pocket, and they'll be like, okay, this scene needs more violence and more boobs, and that's it.
And you're just like, okay, well, what are we doing here? But I definitely felt like we were all like in a nice little collective, or even down to the
PAs
were ready to just.
For example, one of the execs, Ben, he, you know, on another movie, he's supervising this other movie, $40 million movie. You know,
and this wasn't 40 million.
No, okay. It was just 50. Under. It was just under 40 million, actually.
39.9.
And I got paid half of it.
But then on this movie, he's like on set. He's running things around. I mean, everybody, you know, everybody was working. There was no ego, I guess. That's what I mean.
Yeah, there was no ego. Yeah.
Except for him.
Unless they watch this video, in which case they're like,
me.
Why didn't we talk about me more?
I'm sorry you couldn't get the real star of the movie. He was a featured extra. I don't know. You know, Ryan couldn't actually be here. This guy's pretending to be Ryan.
Newspaper boy number three.
These are actually three. We're just three actors that we hired.
Yeah. To pretend to be Haley, Ryan, and Kerem.
Yeah. Yes.
Well, but it really busy. Was.
Can we get team number
it
one?
It was so fun filming this movie.
Yeah.
I don't know that it was fun.
I think it was. It was.
That's a very valid point, though.
No, see,
he really makes a valid point.
It was what it we was did. Fun for me in a miserable way.
Right.
I was doing 100% what I love to do, and I met cool people, and I think it was awesome because we were able to stick. You know how, you know, when you're taking a test, you're supposed to, if you don't really know a question, you're supposed to just go with your instincts, and most of the time it's right. I think that.
That's what I did.
With this film, we were all kind of able.
No, I got poor.
And that's why you're an actor. With this film, we were all able to, you know, go with, like, what the story was meant to be, and I think we were, even though, you know, he had a million things going on in his mind, and he's from a different planet, and. Mm-hmm. There were like hard times, like understanding each other. We were all able to really like keep true to what the story was and what his initial simple story was. You mm-hmm. know what I mean?
Yeah. And we did.
Yeah. Yeah. And
we never. It's funny because like our I mean we I think it was a very serious. It's funny because it's a comedy, but it's the whole making of it. That's when he said, yeah. "Was it fun? Was everyone joking around?"
Oh.
Like. It wasn't no, really like
it
that.
Wasn't like
our gag reel is the lamest.
Yeah, gag it's so bad.
Reel. There was only one funny thing on it, which is Josh Molina.
Oh, he's funny.
When I was trying to, I wanted to add some stuff to a phone conversation, and I was trying to explain to him what it was, and he's just like a master derailer, and just everybody is. I've tried to explain to him. He's like, but, you know, telling him what to say, and he's like, oh. What do you want me to say? Am I saying this? Are you saying this? Are you me now?
Yeah, he's very, yeah. like... Very
there was one clip that was great. Funny. And other than that, there
yeah,
was...
most of it is just, I say a line wrong, and then you hear him go, no! And I go, okay.
That Ryan likes that kind of thing, though.
That, but that's for that
he
really
can take
gets
it.
Me
he can take it, and he's motivated by it.
Like, I love...
Instead of saying, oh, Ryan, what do you think about... I mean, maybe we can go this no. more.
Which I'll is what you had to do to
Ryan,
me.
Ryan, that was bad.
You had to baby me.
Ryan, no.
You'd be like, come on, stupid. Let's go. Action, stupid.
Well, thank you guys.
And goodbye. You can leave now.
I feel a little like we did Lord of the Rings. There were like seven endings to this interview, but we just kept on going.
Didn't
somewhere
we even
else.
Start the interview?
No,
yeah, was that an interview
for the whole time?
No, that red light's on.
And roll it.
Yeah. No, we rolled Got out it. Like 20 minutes ago. Yeah, we just didn't want to hurt your feelings.
This was really fun.
We rolled out right in the middle of your like really, like really honest.
The cameraman's like, no, I'm not rolling anymore. I'm done. Thank you.
Au revoir.
Camera cut.